You didn't think to call me, but here I sit, trying not to cry, asking myself why you do this to me. Oh, baby, since you're not around for me to tell you, baby, face to face, I'm writing you this letter, and this is what I have to say. What you did to me, oh baby, I thought that you were someone who would do me right, do until you played my emotions and you made me cry. Can't take what you did to me. Now I see that you've been doing wrong, played me all along, and made a fool.
Y'all, that fade out on Lama Rod's part, I just want to commend. I know that takes some skill. So hello, everyone, and welcome. Rolling with the new pattern we started last week, which is just to have a brief check-in, convey some information. Yeah, welcome to the Heartbreak Hotel, AKA Medicine Buddha Practice with Lama Rod. glad that you're all here. If this is your first time, welcome. Thank you for being here. You'll get a sense for what the vibe is as we continue. For now, I just would like to direct your attention to the chat. I just dropped some links, www.lamarod.com/events. That should be your go-to place if you want to check out all kinds of different things, either virtual offerings or in-person retreat opportunities, book tour stuff. That's the place to be. If you would like to get connected and support Lama Rod's work while also being able to access things like a daily word and some monthly offerings, and just to be in another container of shared practice and shared interaction together, you're also welcome to check out Lama Rod's Podia community, lamarod.podia.com. Indicated enough, I will share my screen. Yes, I can do this. So this is just Lama Rod's event page. I see upcoming opportunity to connect in person in Atlanta. Check that out. And Lama Rod may or may not have some things to say about these things, but just so you are aware that they're happening. Some opportunities for in-person residential retreat practice in the UK in the spring, as well as the autumn, as well as new Saints Book tour. This will be populated with so much stuff. 2024 is full. And of course, the first Thursday of next month of February, Free Radicals will also be happening. And here's our good old little Medicine Buddha situation. So yeah, that's some of the things to stay tuned for, and always keep checking. And Lama Rod, anything to add? Otherwise, I think it's your show.
Oh, no, thank you, Eric. All right, that was wonderful. Thank you so much. Definitely to Eric and also to Karen behind the scenes doing the tech work. It takes a team now. Teamwork is how we make the dream work, folks. Right. But my teacher once said that things would be easier if it wasn't for other people. I don't find that that's always applicable, but often it can be very applicable. But thank you all so much. Again, thank you, to all of you, particularly welcome to those of you who are new to the practice. This is the practice of Medicine Buddha, and it's a guided practice. And you don't need to know anything or do anything. Everything is going to be given in the chat, the mantras, and so forth as well. I was thinking about Heartbreak Hotel, and that was, that beautiful collaboration between Whitney Houston, Faith Evans, and Kelly Price. And I love Kelly Price. Oh my goodness. And something about the imagery of the Heartbreak Hotel. Like, I just feel like there are so many people. Like, you're just taking up residency and heartbreak. And I don't th you know I don't and that's not what I'm intending. I always talk about heartbreak, but I'm not saying stay in the heartbreak. I'm saying metabolize it, move it, change it, shift it. But yes, it is true that any kind of liberation work actually has to begin with wanting to experience what we're trying to get free from. No matter what it is, heartbreak, rage, violence, whatever trauma, you have to learn how to touch it, right? And to be in relationship with it, or there's no freedom, And there's so many of us right now in the world, particularly in winter, if you're in this hemisphere. But I think there may be some Australians that still hang in with us. But I think it's super early tomorrow for you all. But anyway, in this hemisphere, in this, where I'm at, in, winter, I mean, yeah, it's easy for the darkness and what the darkness symbolizes to consume us, Right. And this is why we entered this season with ceremonies of light. Solstice for me, which is a ceremony of light, Diwali, right, which is the Indian festival and observance of light. I think Advent is, I believe, rituals of light, the coming of hope, coming of light into the world, embodied by, Christ. So, like, you have all of this, like these really ancient rituals of light, because we're always supposed to remember the light as we enter into darkness. The light is what we hold on to when we go deep into the suffering of the darkness, right? I've done a lot of this work. I've done really intensive work like this, just to, like, you just go headlong into the thickness, the intensity of the darkness, right? But you never let go of the truth and the reality of light, which, of course, light meaning clarity, wisdom, and so forth, right? But sometimes you just have to, like, you have to hang on to what you need to hang on to, and you have to dive into it. You have to get into it, but you can't stay there. Like, this is supposed to be temporary work, even though temporary may actually mean years, right? But really everything is temporary and impermanent too. So and to learn how to hold the darkness instead of the darkness holding you. This is the key thing here. I'm not brokenhearted. I'm experiencing brokenheartedness. When I am experiencing brokenheartedness, therefore, it means I am holding the brokenheartedness. I am expanding. This sense of awareness isn't identifying itself with this experience of brokenheartedness, of sadness or pain, however that manifests for you. Right? This is just an experience. This experience, of course, arises out of the essence of everything, which is emptiness and space and luminosity or energy. Right? And we have to hold, that's in a way how we hold on to the light, is when we are very clear not to self-identify any part of who we are with the pain. Everything is just an experience, right? No matter how dark it is, this darkness is just an experience, right? You may have to move into the heartbreak hotel, right? And many of us have, but it does, a hotel really is about temporary. It's a temporary stay, you go there, you check out, right? Now, the Hotel California is a whole nother thing, which I can't get into tonight. But I had a friend who was from that town that Hotel California was written about, and that's but that's a whole nother story to tell. But yeah, to pass through the season of darkness and not get lost, not be consumed by the darkness, not allow the darkness to hold you. It's this kind of courageous, daring practice, and this is what we need. You have to be like fucking courageous and audacious. Some of you are hard-headed people. You're difficult persons, right? And I love that. I love that for you, right? You have to be difficult. That's how we do so much of our work of disrupting. You have to trouble things, but in terms of like being hard-headed, you have to bring that to this practice. You have to be stubborn. in a way, right? You have to be like little Edie. You have to be a staunch woman, right? And you get extra points if you can name where that reference is from. A staunch woman. Where is that from? Where are my gays at? Thank you. Staunch. Like you have to say no. You have to say no. No. No, this is not going to consume me. I am not identifying with this. This is just an experience. And it has to be a lot of force behind that. No. No matter how hard it is just an experience. Right? And that's so hard to hold on to in the depths of really intense suffering. To hold on, that's the light that you're holding on to as well. No, like this is just an experience, no matter how intense this is. Right? And there are things, yes, that we, some of us, will have to manage our whole lives. Absolutely. But how long is a life? Too. I know it seems like forever, and I've been in these places for, certain places for years. Just years, like deep depression for years. Despair, hopelessness for years. Right? But because of practice, like when I started practicing, I really had this liberatory tool, which was letting go of all the self-identifying. And that's what I was holding on to. No matter how long this darkness lasts, it won't last forever. Right? Because it's not just about this life. It's about all the lives that are coming after this one. And everything that we're doing in this life, and it may not seem as if we get far in this life in our practice. It doesn't matter because you've done a lot of work for the next life. Right? Like we're building up. Like we're moving up, we're lifting. We're processing and moving through and metabolizing all this karma, right? And we're getting clear about who and what we are, which is exactly the act of remembering. Like we're gradually remembering, but we have to process everything. And this is why I always say you have to think about the long game. You're here in this space because you're already doing that. And you have been doing that. You didn't just randomly end up here. Maybe some of you did. You think you did. You think you randomly ended up here. But this took a lot of effort to get this life. Like it took a lot of effort to be interested in this shit. Right? And I know it's and it's super complicated as to I know I'm like kind of oversimplifying everything. It's really complicated as well. But in general, it's like we can agree, that this moment and the space that we're sharing and the practice that we're about to do has come about through intense like labor. Right? And sometimes that's how we begin to reorient ourselves, and that's what helped me when I started practicing, when I started doing the traditional contemplations, which are the four thoughts that turn the mind to the Dharma. And the first thing you contemplate, particularly in tantric practice is, you know, just precious life, precious human life. You know, that there's human life, but what we're talking about is precious human life. And what makes human life precious is our capacity to want to get free from the cycle of birth and rebirth. Like, that's when you get precious, right? When you're not, it's more than just living and getting through life and dying. When you're in this life and you say there's much more happening, and I need to remember what that is, I need to get there, I need to experience that. This is when it becomes precious, because you're using it, right, to disrupt the system. Like, what we're doing now is disrupting systemic, like, delusion, ignorance. You're getting clear, right? But what comes with getting clear is the heartbreak, you know, the heartbreak, which can be mourning, you know, and it's easy to get stuck there, and I don't anymore, you know. Everything is a process. Like, everything has a timeline, right? You're working at your pace, not at someone else's pace. You know, I have friends, you know, just Western friends, you know, American friends whose parents converted to Buddhism, and they grew up Buddhists, you know, so they've been in the practice their whole life. And that's wonderful for them. You know, I was born into the Black church, and I think that's really wonderful as well. You know, I don't compare me coming to Dharma when I was 24, roughly 23, 23-ish. Like, I don't compare coming to Dharma when I was 23 and compare that to, like, friends. You know, I don't compare that to, like, Lama Justin, who grew up in a lot of this as well, you know, who, like, lived in India and had all these amazing experiences before I got, you know, into Dharma. I just don't do that anymore, because I came to this at my own time, right? When it was appropriate for me, right? I don't know. I wanted to say that just because, like, I don't want you to compare yourself to anyone. I don't want you to compare yourself to me. Please don't compare yourself to me. You know, it will be disappointing, right? Because I'm a practitioner, but I'm also an extremist as well, right? And so what I do is also the combination of many lifetimes of practice, you know. What our teachers do, for those of you who study with other teachers, other lamas and shamans and everything, and gurus, like, that's the combination of intense practice over many lifetimes. They just didn't drop into this realm, you know, and it became a teacher or awaken or whatever, right? There are many people more advanced than I am. Absolutely. And they're working on their pace. They're working on their timeline. You know, so come back to your practice, come back to your timeline and say, this is where I'm at. You know, everything that I teach, right, which is everything that I practice, I don't teach anything that I don't practice. And I really don't teach anything that I don't have a teacher for as well. But everything that I teach, I've practiced. You know, and you have to start somewhere. Like, I started being completely confused about a lot of the stuff. You know, I didn't understand meditation. I didn't understand these theories, the philosophies. I didn't get anything, but I did understand that this is where I belonged. Like, I knew that. And I also knew that it would take time for me to understand what the practice was and what the terms were. You know, you have to read the books, right? You have to go to the retreats, Right. You have to find the teachers. You have to find the Dharma friends. You have to find the communities. All of that takes time. Right. And I was just patient. Right. And I moved through that at my own pace. I wasn't competing with anyone. I said, okay, what do I need to do right now? Right. What do I need? Who do I need to pray to? Who do I need to be practicing with? How long do I need to be sitting? Right. How do I consume like all this suffering that's coming up in my experience in this moment? And you just go through the process. Right. You pack your tool bag of practices and Dharma and you just get to it. You start working shit out. So let's start working shit out right now. So just a reminder, the prayer doc is posted. Please go ahead and post those prayers as well. And let me make sure I have the right one up as well. And they don't have to be, just again, they don't have to be long prayers. You don't have to use your name if you're offering a prayer for yourself, because you don't have to self-identify yourself. The prayer will find you. The prayer is connected to you. What we do together, you will benefit from as well. So if you're nervous about that, you don't have to put a name or anything, okay? So let's just to start orienting into practice. And I always like to start with just calling ourselves back into the space. If we've drifted off into the future or the past, or we're swirling in anxiety or fear or whatever, just gently call ourselves back to this moment. Maybe even becoming aware of the space that you're practicing in. What you're seeing, what you're smelling or hearing, letting some of these anchors orient you into this timeline. And we come back to this moment and we anchor in this moment, because liberation only happens in the present. Not in the future, not in the past, but right now. So you have to come back to right now. Maybe even noticing the weight of your body. And how the seat rises to hold you. And so let's continue with this central channel breath that we've been working on the past few sessions. Right. So again, just shifting your attention to your sit bones, particularly your tailbone. Noticing just the energy, noticing your back. Right, as it rises from the tailbone. And of course, in that experience of your back is the spinal column, but also the central channel, which runs from the top of the head down into the root chakra, which kind of corresponds to the tailbone. None of this is precise. There's lots of disagreements about where the central channel actually is. But just noticing that. And you can stay here, like really grounding, anchoring attention at the tailbone or the pelvis area. And if you're working with the breath, you can go a little further. And we can begin to breathe in and out of the tailbone. So you're bringing the breath low into the body. And that's going to help to like ground us to get us a little more settled. But again, you don't have to work with the breath as well. So breathing in and out of the tailbone. So going a little further now with the breath, we'll imagine now that as we inhale, we're going to be inhaling up the back, up through the central channel to the top of the head. And then as we exhale, it's like the breath is sinking back down to the tailbone. So as we're doing this, we're essentially moving not just breath up and down the central channel or the spinal column, but we're also moving energy. And in this case, prana, a pranic energy is moving up and down the spinal column slash central channel. And prana is it's life force energy, the energy of life. Right? Prana is what holds our consciousness with our bodies. And when prana begins to weaken, that can begin the death process, the death journey, the transition from the physical into the non-physical. So prana always rides the breath. And this is why pranayama work, which is what this is, breath work, is really powerful because we're learning how to move energy through the body. But particularly with this kind of pranic central channel breath, we're training to get as much prana into the central channel as possible. And that corresponds with deepening experiences of awakening. Whenever, outside of our practice, whenever you're dealing with a lot of emotional energy, try this breath. Like, use this breath to move some of this energy around and see what happens. And this is also a restorative breath as well. And what we're trying to do in this tradition of healing is restore, right? Not necessarily like restrict or purge or diet necessarily, but we're actually all very depleted. And so a breath like this helps us to start deepening our capacity to take, to absorb energies that we really need. Because healing is about being replenished, it's about being full. Wholeness. And if you want even more specific instructions, you can breathe through the nose as you're lifting, and then out of the mouth as you're kind of descending back to the seat. And as you exhale, really releasing, letting go. So in the in breath, as you inhale, you're taking in everything that you need. And as you exhale, you're letting go of everything you no longer need. And now be careful, you're not, as we exhale, we're not letting go of bad things. We're letting go of things that are no longer serving us. So having that kind of language mentally is really helpful. I am releasing energies or experiences that I no longer need to get free. And I'm taking in, as I inhale, everything that I do need. And again, if you're not working with the breath, just doing this kind of like visualization or kind of like work where you're just imagining, open to the things that you really need, right? And at the same time, feeling a release of the things that are no longer conducive for your liberation or healing. Letting the seat rise even more to hold you. And just a couple more breaths here. And coming back to a natural breath. And so shifting your attention now to the space in front of you. And at this point, you can keep your eyes open, you can close your eyes, but we're going to kind of go into our imaginary right now, as we always do, right? I invite you to begin to imagine again all of your benefactors kind of appearing in the space around you. And again, your benefactors are just all the beings who love you, who want you to be free, right? Be it ancestors or family or beloveds or deities or saints, angels, Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, the earth, the elements, anyone and anything that wants you to be free is your benefactor. And imagining that they're just beginning to appear around you, kind of like stars awakening in the night sky. And they're radiating the soft white light into this space around you. Of course, that light is an expression of their love for you. Their deep wish for you to be free and happy and resourced and well and everything. So all as all of this is happening, I invite you to ask yourself a question. And the question is, what do I need right now? What do I need right now? You don't have to have an answer for this. But instead, I want you to pose this question now to your benefactors around you in this form. Please offer me what I need. Please offer me what I need. And slowly your benefactors begins to transform into what you most need, or they begin to offer from their radiance what you need. And try not to think about this, try not to orchestrate this, just let things happen. You don't even have to visualize anything for this practice to be potent. But you've just offered, you've just asked your benefactors to offer you what you need. And this becomes this energetic kind of exchange now. That you don't have to know what it is, but what we're trying to experience is receiving whatever it is that we need. And before we really start taking this energy in, we're going to turn our attention back to our heart centers. I'm going to offer the first mantra, which is Om Nam La Sangye Ki No Soha. Medicine Buddha, please think of me, look at me, remember me. We're going to chant this three times, beginning and ending with an elongated om. And we're going to concentrate the vibrations of the mantra, the first mantra, in the heart center. So in a way, we're beginning to awaken the heart center because this is how we're going to start receiving our these energetic needs from our benefactors is through the heart center. But first, we have to awaken the heart center by calling out to Medicine Buddha. Okay. And we'll begin with Om. Om. Om La Sangye Om La Sangye La Sangye I'm just feeling the awakening of the heart center or the heart chakra. We begin to take in the energetic offerings, these energetic needs for our benefactors. And imagining that this energy is just flowing into our heart centers, beginning to restore parts of our experience that feel depleted or worn, whatever feels that it needs to be supported and replenished. This is where this energy is going. Just sitting and receiving, opening, expanding, being held by the seeds, being cared for by our benefactors, being held by Medicine Buddha. Then we slowly begin to turn to our main mantra, to Medicine Buddha's main mantra. Which you can chant or just listen and just sit and receive whatever feels appropriate for you. And we start this practice not just for ourselves. We're not just taking in for our own restoration, but we are receiving on behalf of so many people around us, including our communities that do feel and experience undernourishment or depletion. We're accepting this energy first, right now, on behalf of so many people who need healing and support right now. And then eventually we'll begin to offer this energy out to others. But for right now, for the first part of our chanting, I invite you, if I can, I command you to just receive from all these beings who are here for you to offer you what you need. Right, we'll begin. Om Deyadam Beyonze, Beyonze, Rasa the sumo gate soa de anda begunze ma begunze razo sumo gate soa de anda begunze begunze ma begunze. Ma begunze, Raza sumuga te soa te anda umbe. Turn our attention to our prayer requests. Of course, we invite all the Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, Dharma protectors, all beings of light, all the spirits and guardians of the land and the elements where we're located, all beings of light as well, all of our benevolent ancestors, all beings who consent to joining us in bringing about the fruition of these prayers and needs for the world, for our communities, for our beloveds, you know, and also for the people we don't like as well. Everyone must be free. So turning our attention to our prayers, we're offering prayers for my aunt Janine. May she heal quickly from her medical procedure. May she be protected as she finds out what is wrong with her health. May she access healing as soon as possible. Offering prayers for my cousin Tanya and her embryo. May the embryo find a cozy home in Julia, the surrogate. May they be safe and protected as they grow. May they know and feel how much they are wanted and loved. Offering prayers for clarity and compassion, understanding for myself. Offering prayers for a civil rights lawsuit against an employer. Offering prayers for T as they move through deep grief and confusion. Offering prayers for my family, mom and sisters and dad, as we adjust to my dad's increasing dementia, as we try to hold each other and support each other. Offering prayers for my brother, Michael, and for my friend, Richard. May they be free. Offering thoughts and prayers for my dad, who is dying. We released him from the hospital to hospice care. We don't know if he has weeks or months left, but we may be free that, but may they be free of suffering with as much sweetness as possible. As some of you know, this has been a 6-year process. We have received many blessings and grace and gratitude. and continue to pray for an easeful transition for your father. Offering prayers and positive energy to my son and our family as we navigate a mental health crisis. Offering prayers for my family that this wedding goes smoothly and everyone shows up embodying love as deeply as they can. Offering prayers that I may continue to be more connected to my guide. Offering prayers for Marsha and Sammy. Offering prayers for my beloveds on their journeys. Offering prayers for Zell, Nia, and Miles, and that they remember and are led by light in this dark season. Offering prayers for myself and my former partner as we work to navigate our transition from life partnership and entanglement. May we be supported in what we each need and work to communicate grounded in a shared commitment of honesty, balance with care. Offering prayers for my beloved wife, who continues to struggle and suffer with acute anxiety. Prayers for my beloved children who struggle with depression and anxiety. Prayers for my sister-in-law who is facing the end of this lifetime and my brother who is by her side. May my beloveds find their inner strength and are open to receiving love and support from those around them. Offering prayers for Ravi's recovery from surgery and infection. Vanina's aches and pains and Rishi's mind for Lama Rod and all connected to Bhumi Sparsha. Prayers for my own body and mind to be well and resourced to continue to do good works and continue with my practice for all beings and all the realms to be free. Prayers of my life's blessings to help all beings be free. Ashe. Offering prayers for Cassidy as she undergoes a mastectomy today. Prayers for an easeful recovery. Offering prayers for liberation from my biological ancestors and all beings in pain. Offering prayers for Jani, who is sitting in the preparation for cancer surgery. Offering prayers for Kat as she navigates aging and loss of some abilities. Offering prayers for myself as I move through this liminal phase and adjust to the new realities of this phase of my earthly adventure. Offering prayers for my older brother who is struggling with addiction and disassociation from life. Offering prayers for my brother-in-law, Roderick, who began his journey into the barter last Thursday. And my friends, David, who left Friday, and Scotty just left us last night. May they all experience an easy journey. Prayers for me, my family, and their families as we grieve their passing. Offering prayers for me as I continue working with the darkness of CTPTSD, ASD1, and the process of now of working with examining ADHD. The anxiety and depression is overwhelming and exhausting. Offering prayers for moving through anxiety, trauma, and seasonal depression. Offering prayers for Jennifer Cowles and her partner, Chris Calico, as he is preparing to transition to the world of spirit. May he be released from suffering and awaken. Prayers for Bethany to heal from her long hospitalization and to be released from fear about the next surgery. Offering prayers for my neighbor experiencing homelessness, Gary. Prayers for me to expand through and embrace the stuck energy I'm working with right now. For the healing of the land underneath me and the plant and animal life that occupies that land. Offering prayers that Carla and Francesca know abundance. May they be protected. May their spiritual and creative practices be supported. May the land they inhabit know their living intention. Offering prayers for Rachel to know peace in the days leading up to her procedure. May she feel accompanied, protected, and supported. May she make a swift recovery. Offering prayers for all women and femmes. May those suffering at the hands of their oppressive states know peace, dignity, and strength. May they know love and stability. Offering prayers for Tom and Stefania to choose freedom. Offering prayers for my Muslim friends and neighbors. May they feel safe and respected. May Palestine be free. May Ukraine be free. May Libya be free. May all women and people giving birth and receiving postpartum care in Palestine be resourced and tended to with love and dignity. Offering prayers from me to offer what's needed as skillfully as possible to support the liberation of my students and the course beginning tomorrow. offering prayers for all those dealing with illness and exhaustion at this time. May we all find ways to feel resourced and rejuvenated. Offering prayers that I find a new job that meets my needs and that my dad can find a good employment lawyer to handle his wrongful termination case. Offering prayers that my neighbors and I can be protected from our predatory landlord. Offering prayers for me and my housing search and for Palestine. Offering prayers for peace of mind, for rest and spaciousness as I engage in the work of my heart that nonetheless feels so very exhausting. Prayers for wise discernment of no. Prayers for Dennis from Mississippi. Offering prayers for my beloved. May they be deeply protected. May we always be held in deep, abundant love. May we find liberation together. Prayers for my son and his peace and well-being. Prayers for my 12-year-old as she navigates her first adolescent friendship complexities. Offering prayers for my radical acceptance and celebration of my body in its infinite magnificence and Buddha nature. Offering prayers for Brian that he may be free from all hungry ghosts of past, overwhelm, and fill the warm, supportive energy of our Sangha. Offering prayers that the 1,000 arms of protection and 1,000 eyes of wisdom will bring divine, diverse discernment to my internal and external blooming and practice of fierce compassion. Offering prayers for a view of abundance and trust that I will move with an open, unarmored heart to send, receive, and offer hospitality to all that arises, that I can move into wholeness and freedom with all beings. Offering prayers for me to experience joy and ease as I complete the biggest project of my life. Prayers for T as she navigates deep grief. May she be held deeply, feel the support she has, and may she be free from suffering. Offering prayers for me. May I continue to be deeply protected from inner and outer harm. May the work that I do lead to liberation for all beings. Offering prayers for myself as I go into my knee replacement surgery starting at 7:30 a.m. on Wednesday. Prayers to feel the love and support of my benefactors and friends. Prayers for so many friends who are also facing difficult situations in their lives. May we all feel loved, held, and may we find what we each have to contribute to the healing of the world from all of our experiences. Offering prayers, ongoing prayers, for all the suffering in the Middle East. Prayers for everyone who suffers from oppression, war, and the inability to find resources they need to care for themselves, families, and friends, for deep peace to arise inside and all around, no matter what the circumstances. Offering prayers for me as I am saddened by the continued canceling of my son's court date that will determine when he's released. Offering prayers for all who have offered care for my daughter during the last month, as we have been so supported. Prayers for the crows and for the rain. I continue to offer prayers for my family, for my uncle and his recovery, for my nephew and his health, and for the deep well-being of my grandmother as well. I continue to pray for the liberation of all beings from all systems of violence and harm, that all systems of harm be abolished so that we may have what we need to remember our own enlightened nature. And I pray for all of those who have offered prayers and even those whose prayers still rest within their own experience unarticulated, that we all have what we need to experience being resourced and cared for and healthy and safe. And may all those connected to us also experience the same resourcefulness as well. And we offer these prayers to all of our benefactors. And as we turn back into our mantra, we begin to imagine that our benefactors, as they are also offering to us what we need, that they begin to also offer into the world everything that has been prayed for, everything that has been offered as a need, may their radiance, their blessing, restore those resources that we've offered prayers for. May the world, through the collective effort of all of our benefactors, be filled with this light of deep healing and deep care, that others are being cared for at the same time we are being cared for, knowing that our benefactors collectively have this intense capacity to offer much more care to all of us than we can possibly imagine, if only we can trust that and just open to what is ours to receive. So turning our attention back into the mantra. O te anta beginze ma beginze razu sumunga te soa te anta beginze beginze ma beginze razu sumunga te soa te anta beginze beginze
Hum beganze
down our home billions, billions in my billions, and other simple judges. Oh, they are down our billions, billions in my billions, and other simple judges. Oh, they are down billions, billions in my billions. Razasumu gatisoa. And so returning your attention back to your benefactors. And they offer a final blessing to the world, to all the people who are struggling for resources. They offer final blessings that they may experience all the resources that they need to get free. And slowly we begin to imagine that they begin to all dissolve into white light. And as this energy is dissolving into white light, we will slowly imagine that this energy of light begins to be absorbed down through the top of our heads, down into our central column, our spinal area, all the way down to our sitting bones, to the tailbone. And again, if you're working with your breath, just moving the breath up and down the central column, just inhaling up, exhaling down, distributing this energy throughout, not just the central column, but the entire body. Up and down. So a few more breaths. Just returning the breath down to the sit bones, the tailbone. Noticing how the seat rises to hold you, feeling the anchoring from the seat. And whatever stability that we experience in this moment, we dedicate this experience to all beings. That all beings may experience deep care and stability in this very moment, regardless of what they're moving through. And that all of you coming up into surgery, that you have everything that you need, that you will be met with all the resources. For those of you in the process of just redefining relationships with beloveds and so forth, that you have everything that you need. For those of you trying to gather certain resources, that you get those resources that you need. And for all of you who are struggling to experience safety, that you are protected and all harm, all negative energy is dispelled. And we do this in the consciousness, the spirit, the blessing of Medicine Buddha. Just resting our minds now, just expanding our awareness into emptiness, just for a moment. Letting go of visualizations and prayers and needs and wants and fear, just resting openly, holding everything within the energy of your awareness. So when you're ready, coming back into the moment and beginning to reawaken your bodies through simple, slow movements, deepening the breath. As we prepare to close out our session, so we turn our attention to the chat and we're going to chant or recite Shanti Deva's prayer three times. We begin. May I be a protector to those without protection, and a leader for those who journey, and a boat, a bridge, a passage for those desiring the further shore. May the pain of every living creature be completely cleared away. May I be the doctor and the medicine. And may I be the nurse for all sick beings in the world until everyone is healed. Just like space and the great elements such as Earth, I always be to support the life of all boundless creatures. And until they pass away from pain, I also be the source of life for all the realms of varied beings that reach into the ends of space. May I be a protector to those without protection, a leader for those who journey. And a boat, a bridge, a passage for those desiring the further shore. May the pain of every living creature be completely cleared away. May I be the doctor and the medicine. And may I be the nurse for all sick beings in the world until everyone is healed. Just like space and the great elements such as Earth, I always support the life of all the boundless creatures. And until they pass away from pain, I also be the source of life for all the realms of varied beings that reach into the ends of space. And finally, may I be a protector to those without protection, a leader for those who journey, and a boat, a bridge, a passage for those desiring the further shore. May the pain of every living creature be completely cleared away. May I be the doctor and the medicine, and may I be the nurse for all sick beings in the world until everyone is healed. Just like space and the great elements such as Earth, I always support the life of all the boundless creatures. And until they pass away from pain, may I also be the source of life for all the realms of varied beings that reach into the ends of space. Well, thank you everyone for your practice. I'm sure it changed someone's life tonight. And just know that it's because of me that happened. I don't want to be arrogant and vain about this, but you know, you just have to tell the truth sometimes. You know, I'm not gonna let Medicine Buddha take credit, honey. But anyway, just this one thing before we go. With Shanti Deva's prayer here, right? I know we always have problems with this, you know, because it's too much, it's overwhelming. And at some point, you have to let go of the fear and the limitations and all these thoughts that says, oh, I can never help, you know, in the same way Shanti Deva is asking us to become medicine, you know, or a bridge or a protector. But you already are for someone, for something, you know, you already are. There are beings who depend on you, right? And maybe you can't see them or notice them, but they depend on you. Your ancestors depend on you, right? You are their bridge into liberation. You know, our ancestors need us to get free as much as we need them to help us get free. This is a joint collaboration, right? And this is why, you know, particularly ancestor practice is so incredibly important for us. If you're really interested in getting free, you have to be interested in doing ancestor work. You know, it doesn't matter if your ancestors were vile beings. Guess what? You descend from them, so you need to do something about it. Because no, the buck stops with you, right? And that's a great thing. It really is, because you have a lot of power to change a lot of beings' lives. If you just practiced and took these practices seriously, and if you just really, I don't know, just open to the resources that more resourced beings are trying to offer you, you will see a transformation. Like, you will become the medicine if you can just take the medicine, right? Take the medicine. It's there. The more you take, the more you become. And you just naturally begin to offer and flow healing into the world. That's all this is. You can't do shit if you're depleted. And so many of you are, you know? And I can't do anything else to make you, you know, get replenished. You know, it's a process. You have to figure it out. You know, as Fannie Lou Hamer said, like, you're gonna get sick and tired of being sick and tired. Like, and that's an incredible blessing, right? When you say no more, I'm tired of being tired, right? I'm tired of being limited. And you're not limited. You just believe you are, you know. And that's the confusion of the state here, is the confusion of this world, is that so many of us, particularly for those of us who are coming out of oppressed communities, like, we just bought into this idea that we're limited, and we're not. You know, if Black people were limited, we wouldn't be here. If Indigenous folks were limited, Indigenous communities would not be here, right? If queer folks were limited, we wouldn't still be acting up and doing embarrassing things at nightclubs. I guess that's what our ancestors died for. I don't know. Like, and so forth and so on, right? You're not limited, like, but you have to let go of the narrative of how limited you are and take responsibility for your power. And I hope this is what Medicine Buddha is teaching you. You know, that you have this incredible capacity to heal. You already are healing. But now just take it seriously. You know, and just let these blessings flow. When you're doing your personal practice during the week, and I hope you're doing a personal practice of Medicine Buddha during the week. You know, even if it's just the mantra, just allow this energy just to flow into the world. You become the sun radiating, healing into the world. That's all you have to do. Let the practice work for you. The blessings of Medicine Buddha are with you. And all the Buddhas, really. Right? Medicine Buddha is with you. Right? And waiting. Right? You just have to take this seriously. Right? All right? Well, anyway, that's it. And I'll see you, something, if something happens this week, I'm sure I'll see some of you in it. Okay. All right. Thank you, everyone.